With the help of two different protocols. So TCP also performs multiplexing, demultiplexing. UDP also performs demultiplexing and demultiplexing, but the way they do it actually differs. So TCP is basically what? Connection oriented protocol. UDP is basically what? Connection less protocol. I hope you all remember this connection less and connection oriented with in terms of sockets. If you have forgotten that, please go back to the video, socket programming video, which is sent as a part of application layer there. Go back to that, go through that, okay, and recall the concepts of sockets. You'll be clearly understanding there. I had explained all these concepts there. I'm just going to explain with respect to multiplexing and demultiplexing here. So first we'll start with connection less multiplexing and demultiplexing. So who does this? Connection less MUX and AMUX? UDP. So that is user datagram protocol running at the transport layer does this. So how exactly this MUX DMUX is happening with the help of UDP, you just see. Okay. So if, I'm going to start from the sender side. Let me call the sender as client here. So host A, you can see, recall here. Yeah, you can see here, this is the host. Where is it? Yes, this is the host, sender host, and this is the receiver host. So sender is actually sending the segments to the server, right? So host is sending this, first is sending the segment to the server via transport layer protocol UDP, right? So UDP has to do this multiplexing job here at the host, sender host, and UDP running at the server side should do the demultiplexing job, that is distribution job at the server side. So here demultiplexing is happening at the server side, and who does this demultiplexing? UDP running here, it does this demultiplexing. UDP running here does the collecting job, that is multiplexing job at the transport layer. Just see here. Sender at the sender side, that is at the client side, a socket should be created first. So socket creation, this is a step using the help of, with the help of the function socket, which is actually defined. You should import a package called socket package there. So there is a call of a function called socket, and I have already explained this addressing format, and the you mentioned here DGRAM, it indicates it is a UDP protocol, that this indicates a datagram now which is sent. So here the client socket, this is the function to create the socket at the client side. So once the socket is created, automatically port address is assigned to this socket by the operating system. Port address also is returned. Okay, so port address is written, but that auto assigned port address, if we don't want, what we can do, we can bind our own port address. You can assign your own port address, but ensure that when you're assigning the port address, that port address is above 1023, because 0 to 1023, those numbers you don't use it to assign, those 0 to 1023 is already assigned, that is the standard port numbers. Those are all standard port numbers which are already used. So 1023 onwards, that is 1024 onwards, 1024, 25, 26, any numbers you can use as a port number to assign. Okay, so here bind this some port number. See, what is it? 19157 is a port number which you bind to this client socket. Anymore you use this as a socket number at the client side. Once the socket is created, what do you do next? Once the socket is created, next you will have to, one second, let me just show you that diagram. Okay, no problem. Yes, so once the socket is created over here, client side, you also should know parallelly at the server side also there should be a socket created, and that socket created also should have one port number, right? So for you to send the address, you should know this, you should add this, your sender's IP address as well as sender's port number. Along with that also you should add what? Destination IP address, that is server's IP address as well as server's port number, correct? So that is done both at the client side and the receiver side. So Yes, so IP. Okay, you can just go through this. When host receives the UDP segment, yes, UDP segment to this, yeah, correct. So this is something like, when the datagram is received at the client side, what should be done? It should check its destination port number. It should check the port number first. So for which socket that should be transferred to, that should be done. So it is something like here, when the UDP receives the segment in the form of a response, so it should be first checking the port number, destination port number specified, correct? So what is that destination port number indicates? It is the socket's ID. Which socket should be first selected here to transfer the message to the correct process? So that is done here at this side upon receiving the segment from the server, correct? Now, so when the client is sending the message, it will send the message to the destination. So upon receiving here at the server side, server what it will do? It will first check the destination port number. That means it'll out of many sockets here, it will first select the socket with the help of the destination port address specified in the segment. So correct socket will be searched, and through that correct socket, delivering of message is done. Similarly, upon receiving the response message here, first it will check the destination port number. So here also at the client side, multiple sockets might be there, out of which one socket must be searched, and through that only the message should be transferred. Okay, so that is shown over here. Okay, you just see what is happening. First, a datagram, one socket is created, and name that socket as a datagram socket. And what is that 9157? It is the port address of the client socket, the socket that is created. Only one socket you have, and its port number here is 9157, which we have just now bounded. Okay, so that particular port number is bound to this socket. So the message is sent here, and now the source port number is 9157, source port number. So what should be the destination port number? You can see at the server side also one socket is there, whose port number is 6428. So that should be known to the client in order to send the message. Yes, so 9157 is the source port number, and what is the destination port number? 6428 should be the destination port number. Now the message is transferred from the client to the server. Yes, you can see that. Once it is sent, it is reaching here at the server side, and through this socket, through the destination port, it reaches the process. So the process, this P1 also wants to send a response. So how will it send a response now? Nothing. Nothing. It has to do nothing there. It just will type the message. That typed message should be sent to the destination. This time, what should be the destination? Reverse the port number. That's all. Reverse the source port number. So earlier this was the destination port number. Now change that destination to source. So this time P1 is sending back the response to P3, correct? So this time what should be the source port number? Source port number is 6428. And what is the destination port number? Response should be sent here, right? So this destination port number is 9157. So 9157, this time it became destination port number, source port number is 6428. So the response is sent back to the destination. That's all. Same way, P1 is again communicating with P4. So first sender will send a message to P1. So how will it send? Source port number and destination port number. What should be the source port number? It is 5775. That is the port number of P4 socket here at the sender host. So 5775 is the source port number. What should be the destination port number? See here, only one socket is there. Via this common socket, only these two hosts are sending the message to this process P1. So process P3 and P4 both are basically communicating with one process P1, which is running at the server side. Is this possible? Definitely it is possible. So P3, it is something like one person, one friend here in Mangalore is communicating with a friend in US. So this US friend, this person also has one friend who is in, say, Australia. This person is in Australia. This person is in India. So Indian friend is sending a message to US friend. Similarly here, Australian friend is also sending a message to this US friend. Both are having one common friend. And that common friend P1 will send back the response to both of his friends P3 and P4. It is possible. So here P4 is sending the message via his port number 5775. That is the source port number. But what is the destination port number? It is the same as this. So what is that destination port number? 6428 is the destination port number. So once it reaches over here, so how will the UDP running here at the transport layer will identify the messages? See, this UDP should identify the message that is received from process P3. It should distinguish between the message received by P3 as well as between the message received, messages received between UDP here running at the server side should correctly distinguish between the two messages that is received from two different processes, P3 and P4. So how will it distinguish? With the help of port numbers it will distinguish. See here, you can see, it can distinguish. In this case, it can distinguish. You can see, what is the source port number? 9157. From P3, it is receiving through the port number 9157. What is this source port number? 5775. Both are different, right? So when both are different, you can say that, yeah, it may arrive from two different systems. But it is not always right. Through the help of port number, one cannot distinguish. But with the help of what it can distinguish? With the help of IP address, it can distinguish. So two different systems will have two different IP address definitely. So this IP address and this IP address system of two different systems will be different. So that UDP running here at the server side will correctly distinguish between the two messages with the help of IP addresses, not with the help of port numbers. Okay? Yes? So now UDP will send the segment here. You can see the response should be sent from P1 to P4. So how will it send the response here? It will just send, it will flip the destination. So send destination, that's all. So this time when it sends the response, source port number is which one? So P1 has used the source port number 6428. 6428 is the source port number. And what should be this destination port number? So from P1 to P4 it should go. So destination port number is 5775. So with the help of destination port number 5775, it will reach correctly to process P4. So once it is received over here, what it has to do? Nothing. So it has to that's all. So here P3, here UDP does the multiplexing, that is collecting all the message and sending it to the destination. So here UDP running at the transport side, what it does, here multiplexing job is happening, that is collecting is happening. So once it is received at the server side, so what the server has to do? Demultiplex, distribute that message to P1. Similarly, P4 has to do here, it has to send the message. So UDP here has to do multiplexing job and send the message to the UDP running here at the server side. So similarly, UDP running here, what it has to do? Demultiplex, distribute the message to P1. So when it has to send the response message, what this UDP should do at the server side? It has to multiplex the message and send the response message to the destination. Okay. So this is how it is happening, multiplexing and demultiplexing with the help of connectionless protocol. So you can see here one common socket which is used in connectionless. Connectionless is UDP. So UDP always uses one common socket via which it is receiving the messages from various hosts using this common source, common socket, common port address. So through this common socket, it is receiving, it is listening to multiple hosts. Okay. What is the other one now? TCP. What TCP does now? Till now we were speaking about connectionless. That is UDP. So what if now instead of UDP, TCP is running in the transport layer? Now here it is basically connection oriented. So connection oriented multiplexing and demultiplexing should take place. What is this connection oriented multiplexing and demultiplexing? Same way. See, here also at the client side a socket should be created. And after the socket is created, please now go through the socket programming. What it has to do here at the client side, where the client is sending, first the connection establishment should take place. So first the request is sent to the server. Server should be ready. After that, it will send back the response. Now the connection is established. Once the connection is established, then only you can see. Once the connection is established, that means what? Server is ready to accept the request. Server is ready to exchange the data between the hosts. So once it accepts the request, server will create one new port number, one new socket it will create. So server side two sockets will be created. One is welcome socket through which connection is established, and one more new socket is created only after accepting the request. And through that new socket this time the data will be exchanged. Remember, right? So this concept, I hope it is clear. So what is happening here basically? So the client side one socket is created. Once the client creates a socket, it connects to the remote server. So connects to the remote server in the sense it now is ready to exchange the data. So data exchange is happening through the socket, new socket which is created in the server whose port number is 12,000. Okay, so you just see here. This is the server which has accepted the request of the client. That means once it accepts, what happens? Server opens a new socket, and that new socket which is opened is dedicated to this host, to this user only. Through that newly created socket, only this host can communicate, and that newly created socket's address also is written. And you remember there, what is it? It's 12,000 port number. That is newly created socket port number. Yeah, you can just see here. Host A is trying to communicate at the client side. Only one socket is there. So here multiplexing is happening. TCP is running in the transport layer. So basically it does the multiplexing job. So first it sends the request through this client socket to the remote server. So when it is sending to the remote server, it should have what? Source port number. What is source port number? 19157 is the source port number. What is that? Client's port number. So what should be the destination port number? So it is the destination port number. First, the message is sent to which socket? Welcome socket at the server side. So what is that welcome socket's port number? 46428 is the welcome socket's port number. Correct? So once it receives the message, the server should be ready now. So once it is ready, it will accept the request. And once it accepts the request, a new socket will be created at the server side. And that new socket which is created will have a new port number, and that new port number should be known to the user for it to exchange the data. So here server will send back the response. So this time when it is sending back the response, you can see it is flipped, right? So what is that? This time source port number is what? What's the source port number? Through which port number it is sending? 46428. So whatever was the destination port, this time it became the source port number, 46428. So to which it has to send? So earlier whatever it was, the source port number, that is client socket's port number, it becomes the destination port number. So server is sending back the response to the destination port number 19157. So this is how the message is exchanged in the first stage. There is a connection establishment stage is shown here. Connection establishment stage is shown over here. You can see here. Okay, now here basically multiplexing is happening at the sender host, and here demultiplexing will happen. After that, to send the response again, multiplexing will happen at the server side, and here demultiplexing will happen at the receiver side. So this is done in the first stage in TCP, and here both the sides, the host and the server, both TCP is running at the transport layer. You can see over here, sender host wants to send a message. So P3 is one process running here, which wants to communicate with the process P4, which is running here at the server. You can see a server here in between. Three processes are running at the server, P4, P5, P6. The server is communicating with host 1, host A. And in host A, one process is running P3. The server is also communicating with one more host, which is that host C. And that host C has two processes basically running, P2 and P3, correct? So two processes are trying to communicate here with the server. Here one process is communicating with this server. Just see how this is happening through TCP. Yes, first host A will start with host A. P3 will send a message. So what is happening here by TCP? What it does? Multiplexing, collecting the message from P3. Multiplexes, sends the message. So how it has to send the message? For it to send, source port number should be specified. Source port number is this client socket's port number. So the port number is included. So what is that port number? Source port number is 9157, and that is the 9157. That is the port number of this client socket. And what's the IP address? Here the IP address is given as simply A. Okay, just specify the IP address. Source IP address A from address, and the source port number is 9157. Where it has to be sent? That message should be sent to the server, right? But at the server, to send it to the server, it should know the server's IP address. So what is the server's IP address? We have taken the server's IP address as B. So destination IP address is B. And also we should know now, see, since this is the first message sent from the client to the server, this should be the connection request message. So now still the connection establishment is not happening. Request is simply sent, and where the request is sent to this welcome socket. And where is that welcome socket? You can see this is the welcome socket, and that welcome socket's port number is specified as 80. And 80, remember students, this is a standard port number used here, and that is the port number of the welcome socket, and that is the message sent initially as the first part of connection establishment. So once this message is received here, once this message is received here, you can just see here what is happening. It is received at port number 80. The socket is correctly, the socket, you can see the TCP running here at the server side will basically do the demultiplexing job. So once the demultiplexing is done, so you can see here that message, connection request message is received. Once the server accepts it, what it has to do, it has to send back the response, right? So how will it be sending back the response there? So sorry, once it sends back the response, you can see the source port number this time is 80. From the port number welcome socket 80, the response is sent. So source address is IP address is B, from the server B, IP address B. Destination is what? To which sort? So to this client it has to reach. So client's IP address is A. So what is the port number from where it received the request? 9157. So it is sent. Same thing applies over here also. Host C also wants to communicate. So two processes are communicating this time. So P2 will first send the request. So what should be the source port number? See, source port number is something like 5775. It is this socket's port number. IP address of this host system is C. And to where it is to be sent? Destination IP address, that is B, server's IP address. And what is that welcome socket port number? 80 is a standard port number, welcome socket port number. One welcome socket only you have here at the server, and whose port number is 80. Okay, so that request is sent over here, 80. Again, this one will send back the response. So how will it send back the response this time? Again, same way how it had sent over here, same way it will send like this here also. Similarly, this process P3 also wants to communicate. First, it will send the request. Again, here also you see the same. This part is same. See, IP address B and port number 80. Here also this part is same. And here also, sorry, where is what? Yeah, here also that part is same. So, P3 is sending the request. P2 is sending the request here. Here again, P3 is sending. All three parts has this part common. Destination IP address and port number is common. Right, so you can see how it is communicating. So basically, demultiplexing is happening at the server side when it distributes the request message, as well as multiplexing will happen when it has to send back the response. So multiplexing is happening here first when it has to send the request message. Here also multiplexing will happen when it has to send the request message. This is happening in TCP. Okay, so you can just see here, this is the concept of connection oriented multiplexing and demultiplexing that is happening. Okay, so just to note one point over here, at the server side, it will correctly identify the messages that it has received from two different senders. So this sender's IP address is different, this sender's IP address is different. So two senders IP addresses are different. So with the help of which, receiver will correctly differentiate, but not with the help of port numbers it can differentiate. Okay, so this port numbers, this socket's port number and this system socket's port number may be same. Okay, may be same. So you can see this socket's port number is 9157. 9157 may also be the source port number of this socket. Why tell me? Because these are the two sockets of two different systems. So in across the systems, port numbers can be same. See here, this socket and this socket, two sockets are belonging to same system, right? So two sockets belonging to same system can never have same port number. So if this is 915, this is 5775, this socket also cannot have 5775. Operating system running in this system will ensure that two sockets in the same system will have two different port numbers. But the socket here in one system and the socket in the other system can have, across the systems, the two sockets can have same port number. So that's why, so when the two messages are received from same system, server will identify, server will distinguish between the two messages. I'll come again. Two messages received from the same system here at the server side. How will it be distinguished? So server can see the destination IP address. Sorry, source IP address. So server will first see the source IP address. See, two messages are received from two different sockets, but server will come to know that those two messages are coming from same system. How is it? So both the messages will have same source IP address. So if it is coming from same system, so both the messages will have same source IP address. So that is how server will come to know that two messages are coming from same system. But how will it identify that it is coming from two different sockets? That is with the help of two different socket port address. Okay. So but two different systems will have may have same port number. Remember that point. Okay, because that you require that for the lab. So I hope this multiplexing and demultiplexing concept is clear. So students, please go through this. Okay, so this is important exam point.